Recorded Books presents A Season on the Wind by Suzanne Woods Fisher. Narrated by Stephanie Cozart. From James D. Watson. Life is long enough for one more chance at a rare bird. Meet the cast. Penny Weaver. Single Amish woman. Age 35, moved to Stoney Ridge from Big Valley, a much more conservative Old Order Amish church, to live in her late grandmother's home. Manages Lost Creek Farm's guest house, where birders come to stay while birding, and also manages her young brother, Micah. Micah Weaver, Amish teen, age 18, has developed quite a reputation in the bird world for his remarkable ability to spot and identify birds, especially rare birds, starting a business as a field guide for avid birders. Ben Zook, a twitcher, non-Amish man, though he had been raised plain, age 37, renowned author and photographer of birds, made his mark in the world of birding with his debut book, Rare Birds, has come to Lost Creek Farm in hot pursuit of a vagrant, a bird seldom seen in North America. Natalie Crowell, cousin to Ben, age 31, lives in Philadelphia, has worked in interior design until her life imploded recently, accompanies Ben to Lost Creek Farm at his invitation, has no interest in birds whatsoever. Trudy Yoder, young Amish girl, age 15, avid birder. Shelley Yoder, Trudy's older sister, age 18, has a beautiful singing voice, avid attractor of male devotion, including Micah Weaver's. Boyd Baldwin, non-Amish veterinarian to Stoney Ridge, 30s, love interest of Natalie's. Hank Lapp, one-of-a-kind Amish man, ageless. Roy King, Amish widower, late 30s. Heart is set on Penny Weaver. Zeke Zook, elderly Amish man, father to Ben, suffers from Alzheimer's disease. David Stoltzfus, wise and wonderful bishop to the little Amish church of Stoney Ridge. White-winged Tern, a vagrant bird that has been blown off course during fall migration. This Eurasian bird, seldom seen in all of North America, has chosen Stoney Ridge for a lengthy stopover, creating quite a stir. It has a sly knack for eluding birders. Birder's Glossary. Accidental. A bird that shows up where it shouldn't, aka casual. Bins. Binoculars. Casual. Birds that fly from wherever to a wrong place, aka accidental. Chase. To chase after a reported rarity. Chick. Newly hatched baby bird. Clutch. Eggs in a nest. Dip. Going after a particular bird and missing it. Dray. Squirrel nest. Fledgling. A young bird with wing feathers large enough for flight. Jinx bird. A relatively common bird that has managed to elude a person's life list despite repeated attempts on their part to find that species. LBJs, little brown jobs. A blanket term for drab songbirds that are difficult to distinguish. Lek. A patch of ground used for communal display in the breeding season by certain birds. Lifer, a first-time sighting for a birder. Nemesis bird, a species that constantly eludes a birder. Rookery, a breeding colony. Snags, dead trees. Spark bird, a species that triggers a lifelong passion for birding. Twitcher, A hardcore birder who goes to great lengths to see a species and add it to his or her list. Vagrant. Birds straying well outside of the regular ecological range. Whitewash. Excrement outside of nest. Chapter 1. Penny Weaver stayed so still that the field sparrow in her yard didn't seem to know she was there. It was better in the early morning, when she could see the solid color on his proud chest. In this late afternoon light, a field sparrow seemed like an ordinary little brown job. After he flew off, she crossed the yard to the old milking stable that her brother Micah had converted into a guest house with the help of a few men from their church. Inside the guest house, Penny took one last look around. On a whim, she had cut a handful of late-blooming chrysanthemums from the garden and put them in a mason jar to set on the small table. The guest house was made up of two small bedrooms, a tiny but functional bathroom, and a sitting area with a wood stove. Against the wall, near the table, was a kitchenette of sorts, a sink, and a mini refrigerator and microwave with power provided by a generator. It wasn't fancy. Certainly nothing like these English strangers were probably accustomed to. But it was clean, tidy, warm. And the strangers had asked the bishop, David Stoltzfus, for a place to stay while birding with Micah. She had to remember that, especially if they were the complaining type. They had asked. If this worked out, it might provide needed income. The bishop came up with the notion of adding a guest house at Lost Creek Farm for birders to encourage longer guiding trips for Micah than the usual one-day outings.
"This could be a good thing for Micah," David had said. "It could be just the thing to bring him out of his shell. And it's good for Stoney Ridge, too. Micah's eye and ear for rare birds seems to be God's means to bring blessings to our town."
It did seem as if the Almighty was working overtime lately to bring Micah out of the shadows. Last January, he'd spotted a black-backed oriole pecking away at Penny's kitchen feeder. The black-backed was a stunning cousin to the Baltimore oriole, but this one lived in central Mexico. It was only the second time the black-backed oriole had been spotted in the United States. Ever. That little bird created a major attraction during its two-month stay, drawing bird lovers from all over the country. As if that wasn't enough, in early March, Micah spotted a roseate spoonbill. While it wasn't hard to notice, goodness, it stood nearly a yard tall, with pink feathers like flamingos, where Micah had found it was remarkable. An overlooked, hard-to-get-to creek that ran along the northern edge of town. It had been nearly 50 years since the last roseate spoonbill was spotted in Pennsylvania. Why it had traveled from Florida, remaining for nearly a month in a creek so insignificant it had no name, was a mystery. Then again, that's what made birding so intriguing. Birds didn't always act or play according to the rules. And now, in mid-November, Penny's brother had sighted the white-winged tern, a vagrant bird, rarely seen in all of North America. Suddenly, it seemed that birders everywhere knew the name Micah Weaver. She heard a noise outside and peeked out the window. The sound of a car coming up the long, steep drive always startled Penny. So different a sound than the gentle clip-clop of a horse pulling a buggy. Opening the door of the guest house, she spotted the dark brim of Micah's hat as he peered around the edge of the barn. She let out a sigh. That boy, nearly 19 and still so shy. He was as gentle in nature as he was tall in height. She hoped David was right to add this whole venture of hosting birders at Lost Creek Farm to Micah's field guiding. She hadn't slept well last night, tossed and turned, anxious. It wasn't typical for Penny to feel unsettled, which only made her even more uneasy. She smoothed down her apron, tucked a stray strand of hair inside her prayer cap, took a deep breath, and crossed the yard to greet the guests. A small man climbed out of the driver's side of the car and waved his arm, smiling.
"Welcome! You must be the man coming to find the bird," Penny said.
An awkward silence followed. Something seemed off. What had she done wrong?
My name is Natalie Crowell. My cousin is the birder.
Oh, no! Penny realized this man was actually a woman with a startling haircut. Crew cut short like a man's, spiky on top, white blonde.
"Welcome to our farm, Lost Creek Farm. It's where my brother Micah and I live. Micah is the field guide you've come for, and I'm Penny."
She was babbling now, nervous, embarrassed. Out of the passenger side of the car, another person emerged and popped his head over the top of the car.
"I'm the one you were told about. Don't feel embarrassed. People confuse us all the time."
"Very funny," Natalie said.
She pulled her big purse out of the car and turned to Penny.
"Ben's my cousin, but we look nothing alike."
That did not need pointing out. Ben had longer hair than Natalie's, thick, dark brown, wavy. He raised his arms onto the top of the car, folding them, leaning forward slightly as he cupped his elbows, and as he did, Penny's stomach dropped.
"The name's Ben Zook. I've come to see that white-winged tern that everyone in the bird world is buzzing about. I sure hope it's not a one-day wonder."
Penny's heart gave one huge thump and then started beating wildly. It was him. Her Ben Zook. Even after 2 decades, she would know him anywhere. She'd always known that one day, somehow, somewhere, they'd meet again. And here he was. He was here for a bird. Of course the Lord would entice him back home with a bird. A rare bird. Just as birds found their way back over land and sea, so God had found a way to bring Ben Zook here. Ben walked around the car to greet her, holding out his hand to her. His movement was quick, graceful, and Penny suddenly remembered that was his way. He was tall, so tall she had to raise her chin to see his eyes. He was so fine to look at that she couldn't help but stare at the sheer wonder of him. His deep voice made Penny think of a waterfall, fast-moving and fluid, unable to hold on to, yet so mesmerizing. Ben Zook was standing just a few feet away from her. Still dumbstruck, she gazed at him, then at his offered hand.
"Do something, Penny. Pull yourself together."
But she couldn't budge. His eyes registered no recognition of her, not a flicker. Penny could see she was a complete stranger to him. Eyes couldn't lie. And still, she couldn't move a muscle. Ben dropped his hand with an awkward smile, then turned away to take things out of the car. He opened the trunk to pull out suitcases, handing one to his cousin. He paused, leaned one hand against the car, swayed a little, and suddenly folded to the ground like a rag doll. Ben felt a gentle touch on his forehead before his eyelids could open. He came to slowly, as if he were waking up from a sweet dream, so sweet that he didn't even want to be roused. He couldn't remember what he was dreaming about, only the mood it evoked. It covered him in calm. His soul was settled, utterly safe. He could scarcely remember ever feeling that way.
Wait. He did remember. He was a little boy, maybe 5 or 6 years old. sick with some dreaded childhood illness like chickenpox, and his mother had put her cool hand on his hot forehead. Just like now. Eyes opening, he blinked up at her. This woman wasn't his mother, and he wasn't 6 years old, and he had absolutely no idea what had just happened. From somewhere far away, he heard warbling sounds, and the world started slowly coming back into focus.
Ben! Ben! Are you okay?
The warbling sound belonged to Natalie. Ben lifted his head, then pushed himself up on his elbows.
Was ist los?
What happened? A plain woman, the one who had touched his forehead, leaned back on her heels beside the car, a stricken look on her face.
Sie ist blässlich ummächtig war.
You fainted suddenly.
Zwar?
Truly?
Ugh.
Not again. He felt himself color and shrugged, feigning nonchalance.
I had a bout of the flu recently. Still recovering, I guess.
He tried to get himself up and felt two large hands under his arms, hoisting him to his feet. Still a little unsteady and more than a little embarrassed, Ben leaned one hand on the car, brushed himself off with the other. What a way to meet people. He turned to face the man who helped him up and realized this must be Micah. Tall and thin, more so than others had described him, but still a boy, Ben could see that. His eyes, mostly. They remained downcast, shy and reserved, even as the two shook hands.
So you're Micah Weaver. I'm Ben Zook.
The boy gave a brief nod. Just a brief, awkward nod of greeting, despite the fact that Ben had traveled a long distance to meet him. Over the last few years, Ben had heard Micah Weaver's name circulated around the Pennsylvania birding community, always with a sense of awe. Apparently, the boy had an uncanny ability to spot birds, especially migrating ones blown off course during storms. Ben hoped Micah Weaver would live up to his reputation. He had a book manuscript due in, one that was on hold, waiting for this white-winged tern. Ben Zook had only two loves in his life, books and birds. In a stroke of good fortune, he'd stumbled onto a way to cobble together those two loves into a career. He wrote books about rare birds. The market wasn't exactly mainstream, but there was a steady and faithful market for it, and for that he was grateful. As Natalie often pointed out, he'd bought himself a job. Happily, it was work that he loved. Penny Weaver, the woman who had first seemed frozen in shock at the sight of Ben, snapped out of her odd stupor and jumped into action.
Micah, would you take their luggage to the guest house? You must be thirsty from your travels. If you'll follow Micah to the guest house, I'll bring you something to refresh you.
Ben glanced at the plain woman as she hurried off to the main house, half walking, half running, scurrying, just the way he remembered how Amish women moved. Quick, purposeful, no nonsense. He felt strangely touched by her care for them, two strangers, until he remembered that this was a business arrangement and he owed her a sizable check for her hospitality, regardless of whether or not he was able to photograph that rare bird. The bishop had made that clear. He had retained Micah's help to find that bird, effectively stopping other birders from hiring him for the duration. Micah lifted all their luggage like it was made of cotton balls and was halfway to the guest house as Ben reached into the trunk of the car to retrieve his optical equipment bag. That he hadn't let Micah touch. He didn't let anyone touch it.
Ben, are you all right?
His cousin looked at him with concerned eyes.
I'm fine, Natalie. I just need some water. I didn't drink enough today.
You spoke in tongues to Penny Weaver.
He scrunched his face in disbelief.
What?
You did! And she understood you, too. It was freaky.
Oh, no.
Could he have spoken in Penn Dutch? No way. There was no way. He hadn't used the dialect since he left the Amish as a teenager. Hadn't spoken a single word of it.
Well, believe it or not, you did.
She looked around, sniffing, scrunching her face at the smell.
What reeks?
He chuckled.
That is the sweet aroma of farm life.
When her eyebrows knit together in confusion, he added, fertilizer. When she still looked puzzled, he added, manure on the fields.
Oh.
That was common knowledge for a man who spent his childhood less than a mile away. A man who might have easily become an Amish farmer himself, were it not for his father. But Penny Weaver and her brother Micah knew none of that, and he had no intention of telling them. He wouldn't lie, but he believed the past belonged in the past. Besides, Ben had always loved change. After growing up in a town that never changed, he loved it even more. Stoney Ridge, in his opinion, was the kind of town that was better to come from than to stay in. But he wasn't really the staying type. He was a man on the move, all the time. Like a bird in that way, migrating 8 months of the year. He doubted there was anyone left in Stoney Ridge who might even remember him. So many, like his mother, had passed on or moved away. Maybe that was the real reason he felt he could return at last. He could be here, could bag this rare bird, yet remain anonymous. He could stay on the fringes, irrelevant to a community that only cared about their own. Then again, maybe he would have followed that bird anytime, anywhere. It was an extraordinary find, the first sighting of the Eurasian species in the United States this year, and the first ever reported in Pennsylvania. It was his nemesis bird, a bird that continually dipped him.
Fische und Jagen macht hungrigen Magen, he murmured.
Fishing and hunting make an empty stomach.
He clapped his forehead. Why in the world did that saying pop into his head? It was one his father often said. The mind was such a strange thing. And how it affected the body, that was strange too. The last year or so, Ben had felt a world weariness that dampened his enthusiasm for most everything, even birding. He hoped this super rare white-winged tern would snap him out of his funk, assuming the Micah Weaver kid could find it again. The way he slipped out of sight after dropping off their luggage in the guest house, Ben got a funny feeling he was as elusive as the bird. Trudy Yoder. She was the one who had told Micah about the white-winged tern. He'd taken the word of a 15-year-old girl. Stupid, stupid, stupid. Trudy was absolutely positive she'd seen it, described it in great detail, startlingly specific. She'd never been wrong before. As annoying as Trudy could be in practically every way, she knew her birds. So Micah took her word for it without verifying the find with his own eyes and posted it as a confirmed sighting on the rare bird alert. Then he added his own name to the confirmation. News of the vagrant, spotted by Micah Weaver, traveled like wildfire. That was when Micah got the first jab of guilt to his gut. A few days later, the moment lost even more of its shine when his sister Penny told him that a twitcher was coming to the farm, an author on bird books, expecting Micah to locate this rare bird like he could snap his fingers and it would appear, paying him handsomely so he wouldn't take other birders out in the field. Micah had been out at dawn every morning, out again each twilight, regardless of the weather, trying to locate that bird. So far, nothing. As a birder, he was honor-bound to tell the truth. It was a cardinal value among those who loved birds. If you cheated about finding a rarity, who did you cheat? Even more important, he was honor-bound to tell the truth because he was plain. It was woven into the very fabric of his soul. The whole thing made Micah feel sick to his stomach. Why had he taken Trudy Yoder's word for it? He knew how easy it was to misread birds. He'd done it himself many times. He certainly knew better than to post it on the rare bird alert as a confirmed sighting, adding his name. In truth, only Trudy had seen the bird, so it should have remained an unconfirmed report. He should never have attached his name to it. So what made him do such a shameful thing? Because his reputation as a crackerjack field guide impressed others, especially Trudy's older sister, Shelley Yoder, who sang like an angel and looked like one too. Because spotting rare birds was easy for him, unlike getting words out from around his twisted-up tongue. It was a sinful thing, a worldly thing, to act like he was a big somebody. But, as he well knew, it was even worse to be a nobody. Micah Weaver, Birdwatching Log. Name of bird, green heron. Scientific name, Butyrides virescens. Status, common bird in steep decline. Date, March 5th. Location, farm pond on Beacon Hollow. Description, adult male, small and stocky with a dagger-like bill, thick neck, hunchbacked body, slender yellow legs, velvet green back and crown, a chestnut neck and breast. Bird action. Crows harassed the green heron as it performed display flights around its territory. Notes. A migrant to Pennsylvania, the green heron is easy to overlook, shy, solitary, and secretive, skilled at concealing itself in its wetland surroundings. It lives around small bodies of fresh water, pond, marsh, river, creek, lake, and its diet is mostly fish. The green heron is one of just a few bird species that use tools. It drops feathers or insects or twigs on the water's surface to lure in fish. Pretty smart. During courtship display, the male loses his dignity. He stretches his neck forward and down and snaps his bill shut, or points his bill upward while swaying back and forth. He puts on a bird dance. This actually happens. What female could resist? Chapter 2. It had always been a mystery to Penny why she felt such a powerful attraction to Ben Zook from the moment she'd first laid eyes on him over 20 years ago. He still had an effect on her. A visceral effect. Her hands trembled and her stomach quivered, and she must have peered out the big bay kitchen window 100 times to see if he was really, truly there, in the guest house at Lost Creek Farm. When Penny was 12, she'd spent a summer here on the farm with her grandmother, who taught her everything about birds. How to be so still as to become part of the bird's world. How to listen to a bird's distinctive call and song. How to identify birds by observing small details, like how its bill was shaped. That summer, she also taught Penny how to draw birds, using her keen eye and memory. In the afternoons, her grandmother enjoyed a lengthy nap, so Penny would finish her chores with plenty of time left over to slip outdoors. She would hike up the ridge behind her grandmother's house, and there she found a world of birds to explore, all kinds. She searched for new birds to report back to her grandmother. The downy woodpecker with its fine hairdo, a magnificent thatch of a red crest.
the small black-capped chickadee, which was living proof to Penny that you didn't have to be big to be bold. The blue jay, a bit of a bully, but even more strikingly beautiful than the meek and timid orioles and tanagers. It was during one of those afternoon hikes when she first laid eyes on the young Ben Zook. She was late heading home and took a shortcut, clattering down a steep embankment, startling a young man who was chopping up some trees downed in a recent storm. He had the most arresting face, high sculpted cheekbones, a long narrow nose, wide-spaced eyes. Peeping under his straw hat was thick brown-black hair, the color of freshly plowed earth. His skin was milk pale. She couldn't take her eyes off him, wondering how she would draw such a face. He tipped his head.
"What's your hurry? You're gonna scare the birds right out of the sky."
"No, I'd never do such a thing," she said, all earnest. He pushed his straw hat back on his forehead. Blue eyes, she noticed, as blue as an eastern bluebird, fringed with dark lashes.
"Why not?"
he asked. "Because..." She couldn't stop studying his face. "I just wouldn't do anything to hurt a bird." A wide smile spread over his face, and she couldn't help but smile in return. If a man could be pretty, he was. Clearly plain, he probably knew her grandmother. Even still, she doubted her grandmother would want her to be talking to a grown man, even a plain man, but especially such a pretty one. She backed away, gave him a curt nod, then ran up the hill to take the long way home. The next day, she tried the shortcut again, and there he was, still hacking away at the fallen trees. He paused and looked over his shoulder.
"Hey, it's you again. You don't live around here, do you?"
She shook her head. "Just staying with my grandmother for the summer." With a final stroke, he cut off a limb, then turned toward her.
"You got a name?"
She crossed her arms behind her back, rocked left to right twice. "Penny?"
"Penny. Like the money?"
She nodded.
"Penny. Like for your thoughts? Or a penny saved is a penny earned? Or penny wise and pound foolish? Or better still..."
And then he sang a few lines from a song that started with someone named Penny Lane. He laughed.
"Guessing from the blank look on your face that you've never heard of the Beatles."
He laid his saw against a branch.
"I could have fun with your name."
She stared at him, mystified. No one had ever teased her about her name before.
"Ever heard this one? What did the quarter say to the penny?"
"I don't know."
"You don't make much sense."
He grinned.
"Get it? C-E-N-T-S.
She tucked her head, hiding her smile. He gave her a crooked grin.
"Call me Ben."
He picked up the limb and tossed it on the woodpile.
"So, Penny, I've seen you more than a few times, scaling that ridge like a mountain goat. What you doing up there in the woods?"
He'd noticed her?
"Me? I like to go looking for birds."
He gave that crooked smile of surprise.
"There's plenty of birds right here.
Just go sit over by that Martin house.
It's a regular airport. Birds coming in and going out all day long."
She jabbed her thumb in the ridge's direction.
"Different kinds up there."
"How so?"
"Well, there's an eagle's nest, bigger than a buggy."
"You're pulling my leg."
"I'm not. Just saw it a few minutes ago. Eagles like to nest near water."
"There's no water up there."
"There is. A pond."
He wedged the saw into a tree branch.
"Let's go."
Her eyes went wide.
"Now?"
"Now. I want to see this mysterious pond. And I want to see a bird's nest that's supposed to be bigger than a buggy."
She hesitated, knowing her parents would disapprove. Yet there was something about this young man that she instinctively trusted. He seemed so terribly,
sad. Even when he smiled, it never quite reached his eyes. So she pivoted and led him back up and over the ridge. He followed her quietly, and it felt strange to be leading a grown man somewhere. She didn't stop until they came to an overlook. "Look," she pointed. "There it is." He stared at the pond, enamored. "I've lived here all my life and never knew it was here."
"Might be new," Penny said. "There's a beaver's dam down that way. I call it Wonder Lake."
He gave a little snort.
"More like a swamp."
He tented his eyes with his hand.
"But I'll grant you this. It must be a paradise for birds."
"There, see the eagle parents?"
From this vantage point, they were nearly eye level to a dead tree in the middle of the pond that housed the enormous eagle's nest in a fork of its branches. Ben's jaw dropped.
"Well, I'll be. Son of a gun. You weren't fooling. That's bigger than any buggy I've ever seen."
He leaned against a rock, so Penny followed suit. She pointed out which was the mother eagle, bigger than the father.
"They had an eaglet, but..."
"An eaglet?"
"A baby bird. They're called eaglets until they're fledglings. That's when their feathers start coming in. Anyway, they had just one, but it died."
"Oh, that's sad."
"People say that birds don't have emotions, but I think they do. Earlier today, the mother eagle sat on the edge of her nest, and her husband tucked his head under her beak like he was trying to comfort her. It was real sweet and sad. Sweet and sad."
"Bittersweet. That's the word for it."
"A bittersweet story."
She gave a little shrug of her thin shoulders.
"Every bird has a story."
"Every bird has a story," he echoed.
He turned to look at her and watched her for a long while. "From now on, I'm going to call you Penny Wise." She rubbed the tops of her knobby knees.
"I expect they'll be leaving the nest soon. No reason to stay."
His gaze went to the nest, fixed on it.
"No, I suppose the reason to stay died along with the chick."
They watched a while longer until he said, "We'd better get back. Lots of work to do before the day ends."
"You're cutting up all those trees? All by yourself?"
"All by myself."
He pushed himself off the rock.
"My father likes to say..."
He dropped his voice an octave and shook his chin like a billy goat.
"Bad thoughts and feelings, they come out with the sweat."
Penny couldn't imagine any bad thoughts and feelings needing to be expunged from such a beautiful, kind, gentle person like Ben Zook. Many times that summer, she would take the shortcut to see if Ben was working on those dead trees. Most times in the afternoon, he was. When she saw him, she would step out of hiding and stand still, waiting for him to spot her. He would slowly turn around, as if he sensed she was there, and his face would light in a smile, even his eyes.
"Well, hello there, Pennywise. What bird did you spot on this fine afternoon?"
He would swing his axe to wedge in the tree limb and tag along after her, always keeping a respectable distance. Songbirds he was familiar with, martins, robins, bluebirds, finches, cardinals, but she showed him birds he'd never seen before, or more likely had never noticed. A red-bellied woodpecker, a white-breasted nuthatch, a tufted titmouse with its peachy-colored flanks. Ben Zook was so easy for Penny to be with. He would talk a little, ask a few questions, but mostly he seemed to be genuinely interested in the birds. He talked a lot about the eagle parents, about losing their chick. She taught him all she'd been learning about eagles from her grandmother. Eagles mated for life. Both parents cared for the eggs and the chicks. When the chicks became fledglings, The parents started tearing up the inside of the nest so it wasn't quite so warm and cozy for those babies. Time to go, they were telling their fledglings. Time to make your own way. One afternoon, they were sitting on what Penny called the resting rock, a large flat rock that overlooked the eagle nest. She'd been telling him about spark birds, that first bird that sparks an interest when you get bit by the bug. Eagles, he said, eyes fixed on the large stick nest. Leaning forward, he rested his elbows on his knees and folded his hands. Those are my spark birds. That's the moment I fell in love with a bird. She looked at his profile. Him. Ben was her spark bird. That was the moment she knew what true love felt like. She was only 12, but she knew. It had something to do with the way Ben listened to her, the way he looked at her, with great respect, as if her thoughts mattered. The last time she saw Ben was the day they'd come back down the ridge after she'd shown him a sandhill crane, a precious rare bird in Pennsylvania. He told her to hold on, went to his wheelbarrow, and pulled out a pillowcase to hand to her. What is it? Sunflower heads. Dried, from the garden. I thought you said most birds like them. She opened the sack and her heart started to race. A gift. He had given her a gift. Thank you, Ben, she said to him, her tone serious. You're very welcome, Pennywise, he said, serious in return. She looked up at him. I'm leaving tomorrow. Back home in time for school. My father's coming to get me. He seemed a little disappointed, but maybe she had just hoped he'd be sorry to hear she was leaving. Well, I'll never see another bird without thinking of you, Pennywise. Thank you for teaching me about them. He doffed his hat. Keep looking for the rare ones. He went back to pick up his wheelbarrow and pushed it toward the barn. She watched him go, watched until he disappeared inside the barn door, and asked the Lord for a gift. She prayed that one day, when she grew up, Ben Zook would be her husband. He was the only one she would ever want. He was a once-in-a-lifetime man, a rare bird. Penny didn't return to Stoney Ridge after that summer, but she never forgot about Ben. She never could. There was just something memorable about him, something that touched her heart. Then, one spring day, when Penny was 19, she happened upon a bookstore. In the window was a display featuring books about birds. One, she noticed, was a book about rare birds written by Ben Zook. There was a picture on the back of the book. It was him, her Ben Zook. She bought the book and fell in love with him all over again. Since then, she'd bought every book he'd ever written. When she'd first returned to Stoney Ridge last fall, she discreetly inquired of Ben's whereabouts. She found out that he'd left home a few years after that summer they'd met and had never returned, not even for his mother's funeral. She took a meal to his father, out of kindness, and when she saw how lonely he was, how cast adrift he seemed, she started to visit him regularly. When the bishop learned that she was making those visits, he asked her if she would be willing to make meals for him and do some housekeeping, laundry and cleanup, for a wage. The bishop told her that Zeke Zook ran most people off his property, sure they were stealing from him, but he seemed to trust Penny. She would have helped Zeke Zook even without being paid, because she felt close to Ben when she was caring for his father. Being there, in Ben's childhood home, knit her heart to him. She imagined him running up and down those stairs as a boy, sitting at the kitchen table as a teenager, crossing the yard to the barn as a young man. And now Ben Zook was here. still such a beautiful man with a tender affection for birds. He was back in Stoney Ridge at last, and staying on her property. She peeked out the window one last time, saw that the lights had gone out in the guest house, and so she went to bed. But she barely slept. Her spark bird was back. So quiet. Ben had forgotten how quiet life could be on an Amish farm. Now and then, familiar sounds would puncture the silence. The bark of a dog, the bawl of a dairy cow, the clip-clop of a horse and buggy along the road. Gentle and comforting sounds, especially compared to hearing gunshots blast away in the night while he was in Honduras recently. He glanced at his watch. Past 7. He rolled out of bed and went into the bathroom, flicking on the light. He looked in the mirror. His eyes were bloodshot and his face raspy with beard stubble. The flu bug he'd been fighting since he'd returned from Honduras was back in full force, churning his belly. He went into the living room area to get a glass of water. The refrigerator had been stocked with some basics, enough to make a sandwich for dinner together last night and eggs for breakfast this morning, but he would have to get to a store. Then again, maybe Micah Weaver would help him find that white-winged tern today and he'd be able to leave Stoney Ridge behind. The thought cheered him. No sound came from Natalie's room, so it was safe to assume she was still asleep. It pleased him that his cousin had agreed to come with him, and even more so that she was able to rest, to truly rest. When she picked him up yesterday, she'd looked worn down. He worried about her. She'd taken it hard, that divorce from Joel the jerk. Natalie had asked him to please stop calling Joel a jerk, so he tried not to say it aloud. But Joel was a jerk. What kind of a man broke his wedding vows for another woman and made it sound like it was nothing more than turning in a car for the latest edition? A jerk. He'd never been crazy about Joel. The guy was always dropping names, trying to impress. Still, Ben knew that his bias had little to do with Joel and everything to do with his loyalty to Natalie. Second cousins, but she'd always been like a little sister to him. Ben grabbed his coat and binoculars and opened the door to sit on the stoop, listening for birdsong, identifying their calls and songs before he could spot them. His favorite way to start the day. He noticed Penny Weaver over on the side yard, hanging a brightly colored quilt on a clothesline. Almost as if she sensed he was there, she turned around, lifted her hand in a hesitant wave, then hurried into the house, as if the mere sight of him made her flustered. She had a slightly bewildered look, or maybe it was just the way she looked at him. As if he were a rare bird that had flown in to land at her bird feeder. Or maybe this was the way all Amish looked at those who weren't part of their clan. It occurred to him that he'd never been on the outside looking in before. He'd stayed away. Until now. Today. Today was the day he would find that elusive bird. He rose, maybe a little too fast, and had to hold on to the porch railing for balance. First, he would have to track down the elusive Micah Weaver. Micah Weaver, birdwatching log. Name of bird, bald eagle. Scientific name, Haliaetus leucocephalus. Status, low concern. Date, February 21st, first sighting this year. Location, Wonder Lake. Description, nesting pair. Bird action, male and female repairing nest from winter damage. Notes. Penny says this bald eagle nest, an eyrie, has been at Wonder Lake for over 20 years, possibly longer. Today, both eagles kept adding materials to it, but the female was in charge of where the sticks were placed. Each time the male brought something in, sticks for the outside or moss to line the inside, he would proudly set it in place. The female would wait patiently until he flew away and then move his latest acquisition to where she wanted it. Pretty smart lady. Chapter 3. Micah had risen before dawn to continue his search for the white-winged tern. He had stopped at the neighbor's phone shanty to check the rare bird alert, hoping there'd been a sighting of it. Nothing, though there was a confirmed report of a Caspian tern hovering around Blue Lake Pond, and he wondered if the white-winged tern might be found nearby, especially during feeding time. It occurred to him that Trudy might have mistakenly spotted the Caspian tern, and if so, then he would seem like a complete fool to other birders. And if that wasn't enough to make him feel terrible, he worried he was growing prideful. 3 hours in the cold morning air weren't wasted. He spotted a snow goose that had been reported on the rare bird alert but unconfirmed, a long-billed dowitcher, and a black-crowned night heron. He even saw the Caspian tern, but not its distant relative, the white-winged tern. The morning cheered him up, because after seeing the Caspian tern, he had confidence that Trudy would know the difference between it and the white-winged tern. Cousins, perhaps, but very different. On his way home, he drove down a certain tree-lined road, and his horse, Junko, slowed to a walk as they passed the Yoder's farm. It was their habit. Micah came down this road each time he was out in the buggy, even if he was heading in the opposite direction. He was always hoping for a glimpse of Shelley Yoder. Once she happened to be coming out of the phone shanty just as he passed, and when he tipped back the brim of his hat, she waved, giving him a friendly smile. That lifted his spirits for the rest of his day. One smile from Shelley Yoder could do that to a man. Micah ran a hand along his whiskerless chin and peered out the side window for a sign of Shelley, but the farm looked deserted. He gave the reins a little shake, and Junko recognized the signal to pick up his pace into a fast trot. Micah's stomach rumbled. It was just as well that Shelley wasn't around. He was hungry as a bear and needed a shower. And suddenly, running across the road to greet him was Shelley's younger sister, Trudy. He yanked on the reins, and the light buggy he was driving slewed to a stop, nearly running over Trudy and raising a whirlwind of dust. Normally, Micah took great pains to avoid Trudy, which wasn't easy, considering he was courting Shelley. Trying to, anyway. He hadn't gathered enough courage yet to ask her to go anywhere with him, but he planned to. Trudy, on the other hand, had a knack for being ever-present. She found Micah wherever he happened to be, badgering him with endless questions, but she never stopped talking long enough for him to get the answer out. She ran to his side of the buggy, a huge smile wreathing her face. "Look, Micah, look what I found today!" She held out her cupped palms to reveal a tiny hummingbird nest. "I don't think it's a ruby-throated nest. Could it be a rufous?" He took it from her to examine. Too small a nest for a rufous. "I found it on a tree branch." He gave her a sharp look. "Now, don't give me that look. The branch was knocked down during yesterday's rainstorm."
"Any sign of the white-winged tern?"
"Nope. Haven't seen it since last week. Have you spotted it again?"
He shook his head, his eyes fixed on the nest in his hand. He passed it back to her.
"I'll let you know the minute I spot that white-winged tern. The very minute I'll come running. I know it's still here."
"How?"
"I just feel it in my bones."
She frowned, peering at the nest in her hand.
"You don't suppose... could it be? A calliope?"
Slowly, he nodded. The calliope hummingbird was an accidental for Pennsylvania. Rare,
But now and then, one or two would be spotted. It was unusual for it to breed here.
Good find.
She smiled. I thought so, too. Her small eyebrows drew together, as if tugged by complicated thoughts.
At first I thought it might be a bee hummingbird, it's so small, but then I remembered that a bee hummingbird is the size of a bee, and they live in Cuba, which is far, far away, so I knew it couldn't be...
Micah's grip on the reins shook a little, and Junko jolted forward. He glanced in the mirror to see Trudy, staring at the nest like it was made of gold, still talking a blue streak. He wondered when she might realize he'd left. That girl could talk a gate off its hinges. He had to smile at the sight of her. Skinny as a rail, brown hair wisping out of her prayer cap like feathers. Dressed too short, she looked like a sandpiper with those long, skinny legs. Her eyes were dark, too big for her small, freckled face. Plain in the plainest sense, that was Trudy Yoder. She was nothing like her sister Shelley. It was like comparing a brown sparrow to that black-backed oriole that had come for a long stay at the farm. A monarch butterfly crossed right in front of him, narrowly missing a collision with the buggy's windshield. Micah was impressed at how it veered out of the path so quickly. Monarchs were the only butterfly that migrated like birds, though different from birds in that they required successive generations to migrate. This one was probably the third in the line from far-off Mexico, where the monarchs gathered each winter. This one, he thought, would probably make it all the way from Canada to Mexico, where its great-grandparents started off in the spring. Watching it out the buggy's open window, he wished it a safe journey. Slowly, Natalie opened her eyes. The room wavered before her, hazy from sunlight streaming around the edges of the window shades. Where was she? Then she remembered. She was somewhere on an Amish farm in the middle of nowhere with Ben. She shut her eyes again. Why had she agreed to join him on this lark? Because her life was at a dead end, a complete stop, DOA. 24 hours ago, she was on the window seat in the kitchen, her legs curled underneath her. That's where she spent the bulk of her days, mostly staring out the window, watching the rest of the world carry on with their lives in a way she couldn't seem to do. She was definitely not coping well with her grief. Not in the way her cousin Ben, more like the brother she'd never had, expected her to be by now. Not in the way she should be if she wanted to move on with her life. In the midst of that surge of self-pity, Ben called from somewhere in Pennsylvania, where he'd been tracking migrating birds for a book. Natalie, glad you picked up. The rare bird alert said they think there's been a sighting of a vagrant over in Lancaster County. An unusual find. I'm driving back to your place to pack a few things, then planning to head over there. She rolled her eyes. Ben and his birds. Then it struck her that he said he was going to head over to Lancaster County. Was he serious? She couldn't imagine he would ever, ever choose to return to the place he'd left behind. Ben, slow down. Have you thought this through? Thoroughly thought out. There's an Amish kid I've heard about who's supposed to be the best field guide in the state of Pennsylvania. He's the one who spotted this bird. An Amish farm. An Amish boy. All to find a silly bird that can't find its way home. Silence. There's nothing silly about birding, Natalie. Oh, yeah, there was, she thought. And you think that going back to an Amish farm is the way to do this? After how you felt when you first left? You vowed to never return. Natalie well remembered. Here's an idea, he said, ignoring her objections. How about if you come along with me? She sat straight up. No way. If you recall how my life is a complete disaster, then you'll remember that I'm trying to find a job before my house gets foreclosed on. I'll give you the money you need to hold on to your house. There's no way I'd let it get foreclosed on. Sweet, very sweet, but not practical. Not a lasting solution. Not when you're 31 years old, newly divorced, and deeply in debt. She couldn't expect Ben to keep bailing her out. She had to get her life figured out. I'm pretty sure there's a job offer in the works. The interview went really well. Extremely well.
That's great, Nat. Good for you. So, I'm planning to stay on this Amish farm while I'm out in the field looking for this white-winged tern. My publisher delayed my manuscript deadline so that I can add the story and photographs.
A ping from Natalie's computer indicated an email came in. She just had a feeling about this job. This would be the one. Jumping up from the kitchen seat, she bolted to her computer on the dining room table. Half listening to Ben ramble on about this bird that got blown off course in a storm, she read the email. Natalie, I'm sorry to inform you that we've offered the design position to someone else. We feel you're overqualified for what our firm needs. Best wishes to you.
Overqualified, Natalie thought. Last week I was told I was underqualified.
Her shoulders slumped.
When will I ever catch a break?
Still there? Her cousin's voice jolted her back. Still here.
So what do you think? Want to come?
Want to come where?
To the Amish farm. It'll be nice and peaceful and relaxing. Just a couple of days. He paused.
I'd really like your company, Natalie.
There was something in his voice that made her realize that for all his nonchalance, this trip wouldn't be easy for him. Her eyes flicked back to the email.
Yeah, sure. Count me in.
And that was how she ended up on this Amish farm with that pungent tang of sour manure wafting through the air. She pulled the covers over her head and rolled over to go back to sleep. Life was all about the constructive use of time. Minutes until water in a kettle boiled. Hours until the sun dried the laundry hanging on the clothesline. 2 days until Zeke Zook expected Penny to come by with a hot meal and kind word. Like all the women she knew, Penny was a person of activity, moving purposefully through every waking moment. She turned off the stove burner and covered the large pot of cherry jam she'd been stirring. Her face was flushed from the heat of the stove, her dress and apron splattered with pink spots. This morning, she had awoken with a memory that Ben Zook had liked her cherry jam. More than liked it, he had raved about it. Whenever she had made it each springtime, she thought of him, of bringing it to him on that summer day and how pleased he'd been, opening the jar right then and there to scoop it out with his finger. He'd pronounced it the best cherry jam in all the world over. What a strange thing memory was. A certain smell or taste and touch of the breeze, and Penny was a young girl again. There were times when she wondered if this was a trace of the image of God placed in each human being, the ability to hold memories, to hold on to the feelings they evoked. She wondered if Ben Zook might remember her after a taste of her cherry jam. She shook her head. Foolish girl, she told herself, though at 35 she was hardly a girl. What was to be gained by trying to connect to Ben? She didn't know. She just couldn't help herself. It seemed as if decades had peeled away, and she remembered the sheer joy of being with him up on that ridge, sharing her birds with him. And suddenly, there Ben Zook was. She saw him through the kitchen window, peering through his binoculars at the hummingbird feeder she had hanged outside her kitchen. She wiped her hands on a dish rag, pushed some wisps of hair under her prayer cap, and hurried to the window to see what he'd seen. At the feeder, Penny saw a male ruby-throated hummingbird hovering. Then it darted away, off to find another food source. She saw Ben's binoculars drop to his chest, so she opened the door. He walked toward her, giving her a charming smile.
"Do you see the ruby-throated hummingbird very often?"
"Oh, I do."
She tried to sound nonchalant, though her insides quivered like jello.
"They return each year to the same area."
The little bird whizzed past them again to hover near a potted salvia plant near the kitchen door, and their eyes followed it like...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.